The early morning hours of October 16th, 2006, in the Dallas, Texas suburb of Wylie.
It shook my whole house. You would have thought a bomb had gone off.
An explosion caused by a gas leak. It blew Benny and Martha Cryer out of their bed and trapped them under burning rubble. Neighbors tried to pull the Cryers to safety, but the flames were too intense.
My husband kept and tried to keep the hose on them to keep them from burning. I mean, we didn't know what else to do. You know, we couldn't quite reach them because it was so hot.
Oil and gas business is part of this state's heritage. I mean, it's our heritage to drill. It's our heritage to walk around with big wads of cash from the oil and gas patch. You know, we got to be who we are because of big oil and now big gas.
Atmos Energy, one of the largest natural gas distributors in the country, is headquartered in Dallas. It's the company that provided natural gas for Benny and Martha Cryer before the Wylie blast took their lives. Immediately after the accident, the state of Texas began a probe that would look into whether or not Atmos had any responsibility in the explosion. But that wasn't the only investigation that would be launched. At WFAA, a Dallas TV station, news director Michael Valentine wondered, could the Cryers' deaths have been prevented?
And that's when the news director, an assistant news director, called me over and Mark Smith, my producer, over and said, guys, I want you to do this story from an investigative angle.
Reporter Brett Shipp began his investigation in an unorthodox fashion, investigating the present by revisiting the past. 6 years earlier, he had covered another gas explosion that had torn apart another neighborhood. More lives had been lost.
Seems like yesterday. You know, the same tree here and the same houses. But when I look at the new house, then it brings me back to reality.
Today, the house where Sidna Gordon's mom and dad lived has been rebuilt. She took expose there.
People who lived several miles away heard the explosion. Now there wasn't anything left. This necklace that I have on is about the largest item that we picked up, just pieces of mother's china.
The accident haunted Sidna Gordon. She wanted to know why it had happened. She knew that's what her dad would have wanted, too. After World War II, Albert Hulbert worked as a metallurgist in the oil industry. His expertise, investigating pipeline accidents.
People die when equipment fails in the field. And so Daddy always considered it crucial to know what happened, that if it was a problem, that it got fixed. He risked his life to fly B-24 bombers. And then to die like that was just awful. This is the accident report, such as it was.
An attorney, Gordon began her own one-woman investigation.
She had filed voluminous open records requests looking to see if there was a pattern, a history of neglect on part of not just the gas company, but perhaps a state agency.
Through her research, Gordon learned about a plastic pipe called Poly One. It carried gas to her parents' house and to thousands of other homes. It was prone to cracking and dangerous leaks. In 1998, 2 years before the explosion, the National Transportation Safety Board sent out a nationwide warning about the danger of Poly One pipes. But at the time of her parents' death, gas companies had only performed intermittent removal. Sidna Gordon spent years trying to understand why federal warnings had gone unheeded.
She filed open records requests with the agency in Texas that regulates the gas and oil industry and is responsible for investigating gas explosions. It is known as the Texas Railroad Commission.
She had asked for a lot of records, just a lot of records. And both Brett and I looked at each other and said, records? What kind of records do you have?
She said, I've still got that box of documents. The response to my records request is in my possession. And Mark and I were like, well, can we see it? And she goes, yeah, I've got it right here. Sidna Gordon had no idea what was in that box, but it was a treasure of information, and it was a roadmap to the truth.
But Shipp wouldn't realize the importance of that box of documents until much later. For now, Shipp would learn from combing the WFAA archives that over the years there had been many serious explosions due to gas leaks in Texas. Several had caused deaths. He wondered if that signified a problem with the state's natural gas infrastructure.
I called the Railroad Commission and I sent an open records request, and I wanted a list of all the incidents involving explosions and injuries and deaths over the last 6 years, going back to 2000.
He says he was directed to the commission's website, where he found lists of incidents with few details. It wasn't the information he was looking for.
That was part of my resolve at that point, was this is going to take a while.
Unlike most oil and gas regulators across the nation, the three Texas Railroad Commissioners are elected rather than appointed. Michael Williams is the commission's chairman.
Three commissioners, statewide office. They spend on average $1.6 million to get elected to that office, a winning campaign, and they take a lot of special interest money from the very industry that they regulate.
One of Shipp's sources for his reporting was Andrew Wheat, head of research for a political watchdog organization in Austin, Texans for Public Justice.
Here on this screen, we have the top contributors to Friends of Michael Williams. Who are Michael Williams' friends? Here at the top, we have a $50,000 category. We have two donors. One is West Texas Gas.
According to Wheat's examination of public records, Michael Williams' political campaign chest has taken over $1.2 million from oil and gas interests since 2001. That sum includes some $60,000 from Atmos Energy, Atmos Political Action Committees, and interests associated with a company called TXU. In 2004, TXU sold Atmos the gas pipeline system at the center of the Wiley accident probe. The Railroad Commission's safety director is Mary McDaniel. 5 months after the Wiley explosion, the one that killed Benny and Martha Cryer, McDaniel released her final report on the incident. It blamed the explosion on the failure of a compression coupling, essentially the connection between the Cryer's gas line and their gas meter. In this photo from the report, you can see on the left an orange pipe, the gas service line. On the right is an angled pipe, known as a pre-bent riser, which goes to the meter. The coupling is what is supposed to join them. If the connection comes apart, as it did in this case, potentially deadly natural gas leaks out. Brett Shipp would soon air this report.
A state Railroad Commission investigation released last March found that a faulty natural gas coupling under the alley caused the explosion that leveled this house, killing Benny and Martha Cryer asleep inside. In the hours that followed the Wiley explosion, Atmos Energy scoured the neighborhood and found 21 defective riser pipes and couplings that needed to be replaced. Gas leaks were everywhere. In a letter dated April 25th, Railroad Commission Safety Director Mary McDaniel issued a safety inquiry letter to all gas service companies in Texas seeking information about any leaks or failures of compression risers and any information regarding the recommended discontinuance of these risers. Atmos officials say they have discussed the compression fitting safety issue with Railroad Commission officials and are complying with all requests.
But Shipp understood. The Railroad Commission was not asking Atmos or any other company to replace that old equipment. It had only ordered that gas companies survey its use. Something else caught his eye. Though Atmos Energy owned and operated the gas system beneath the Cryer's Wiley home, in the cover letter to her final report, Safety Director McDaniel found no alleged violations of the applicable safety regulations on Atmos's part. In fact, she praised Atmos. "Your efforts to maintain the pipeline facilities have resulted in this favorable report. We appreciate the assistance given during the investigation." The report said its investigation focused on what it called third-party excavation activities and suggested that may have caused the explosion.
That somebody else came in and somebody else caused this pipe to break. Somebody else's fault.
But though the Railroad Commission had wrapped up its investigation, Brett Shipp was moving steadily forward with his. He traveled to the commission's headquarters in Austin, the state capital, and asked to see all records related to the Wiley investigation. Because the investigation was closed, the records were publicly available.
I think one of the key smoking guns that we found on file at the Railroad Commission was this draft report coming from the field investigators.
It was a preliminary report about the Wiley blast, one authored by a Railroad Commission engineering specialist who had personally investigated it, Alfred Garcia. And it differed from the final report in one significant detail. The final report had said the commission's investigation focused on third-party activities, but that was only partly the case.
This was their submission to their boss, the safety director, and their proposal for the wording of the final report to be as follows. There's a possibility of the separation of the service line from the compression coupling due to shifting of soil, due to natural ground movement. In other words, guess what? This compression coupling in the ground pulled out because of the movement in the ground. That's what the investigator and his boss wanted to put in the report. Here's the same page of the final report. What's the cause? The incident focused on third-party excavation activities. No mention of shifting of the soil.
If an aging coupling could come apart due to naturally shifting soil, Shipp reasoned, it was possible Atmos should have known of the risk. And this part of the state had plenty of naturally shifting soil.
And we could see that there was a real systemic problem, that Dallas, North Texas in particular, with this real expanding soil, where we have hot summers, droughts, and then huge rainfalls, massive rainfalls that'll come in. It causes that soil to fluctuate, mixed with these couplings that have been in the ground, in many cases for 30 years or more, and knowing full well that they're probably wearing out, there was a lot of pressure to try to get this story out there.
The reporters didn't appear to be the only ones concerned about compression couplings. Alfred Garcia, the investigator, had recommended in late 2006, some 3 months before the commission's final report, an expedited program to phase out the use of pre-bent risers, which join at the coupling to gas lines. And as early as 1985, the National Transportation Safety Board had warned of the dangers of pipes pulling out of couplings. But McDaniel's final report had required no action by Atmos. According to Atmos Energy's own estimates, the company still had tens of thousands of compression couplings in the ground. Brett Shipp thought they might be ticking time bombs. He wondered how many previous gas explosions could be linked to problems with them. But to find a pattern, he would need more documents. Then Shipp and Smith remembered the box of documents given to them by Sydna Gordon, the attorney who had investigated her own parents' death in a gas explosion some 6 years before. Though that blast had nothing to do with couplings, Gordon had documents going back decades. The box might be filled with precisely the kind they'd been looking for.
Compression coupling, 12-1977 in Temple. Line pulled out of the coupling, 8-1372, Lake Dallas. 10/29/2000 in Little Elm. I was rather surprised when Brett told me that apparently some of these records aren't available anymore, so I'm very glad that I have them.
When you have that paper trail that we didn't know existed, she didn't know existed, but it was all in these incident reports that she hadn't gone through, that we started going through, that showed, wow, the Railroad Commission knew or should have known going back years that they had a problem that they never connected the dots to or didn't want to connect the dots to.
Armed with Gordon's documents, Smith and Shipp were now able to piece together a pattern of coupling failure that stretched back a quarter century all across the Dallas area.
The first real problem was in Keller, Texas. There was a house explosion where one individual died. That was in 1980. Then in 1998, in Arlington, right here, three people were seriously injured in an explosion. Then in 2000, there was an explosion that killed one person and injured another in North Richland Hills in 2000. Then in 2001, we tracked a case in West Dallas here where four people were badly burned. And then in Wiley, you had the Cryer deaths, the two deaths, in October of 2006.
Now Shipp says he requested interviews with Commissioner Williams and the other two railroad commissioners. The requests were denied.
I mean, I knew that time could mean lives. And if we sat and waited for them to respond, somebody else could die. In fact, somebody else did die. Two other people died while we were waiting to get answers.
It happened in May of 2007.
This is where Mrs. Pollock was sitting when they had the first explosion.
It was another gas explosion, this one in Cleburne, Texas. It would eventually be linked to a faulty coupling. As the team tried to understand the coupling's deadly legacy, they learned that other states, including Ohio, New York, and Minnesota, had all had serious problems with the aging piece of gas hardware. In Minnesota in 2004, a huge explosion, which killed three, led the state to order the removal of 30,000 compression couplings. Shipp wanted to know why Texas had not done the same.
We're suggesting to the Railroad Commission, folks, we've got some very powerful information that suggests that this is an ongoing problem that you guys knew or should have known about. We want to talk to you about it. And I got no response. I was put off. And I had no choice but to go down to the Railroad Commission to get some answers.
Shipp returned to Austin to attend a public meeting of the Railroad Commission, chaired by Michael Williams.
Okay. Yeah. Will he be available at some point?
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
Yeah.
I remember that day when we showed up unannounced at that commission meeting, the commissioners knew we were in the room. They knew who we were. And as soon as the meeting was over, they took off out the back door. They were gone. So that left just me and the safety director there to talk about it.
The safety director was Mary McDaniel, the same official who had found no fault with Atmos Energy in the Wiley investigation.
Hey, Mary. Hi, I'm Brett Shipp with Channel 8 News. Can we talk to you about your concern about the non-restraint compression coupling danger that may or may not exist?
The commission has initiated a survey, a study, to look into compression couplings. We started that back in April.
Right.
Still working on it and modified it this month of July.
But the initial recommendation was to do away with those. The initial recommendation was to have all the gas companies remove those prevent risers and compression couplings because of a history of danger and tragedy.
No, that's not what I'm aware of. My field inspector had sent a recommendation in his evaluation just dealing with Atmos. And when we discussed it, he didn't have anything to back that recommendation up.
So you don't think there's imminent danger for people in North Texas through failure of these couplings?
At this point, no.
No.
After a year-long investigation, Shipp and his team were ready to go to air.
Live from Victory Park, this is News 8 Now in high definition. Over the past year, News 8 has amassed hundreds of documents and spent countless hours to unearth the truth. Our finding, that tens of thousands of North Texas lives may be at risk. Investigative reporter Brett Chip joins us now. He's got details for us. Brett?
John and Gloria, when Benny and Martha Cryer died in a house explosion in Wylie 1 year ago, the Texas Railroad Commission, the agency that regulates the natural gas industry in the state, took over the investigation. But were they really in search of the truth, or have they, in effect, helped bury a deadly secret that lurks beneath the North Texas dirt?
Over the next 2 weeks, WFAA unleashed a 7-part series.
On file with the state, memo after memo, dating back to the early 1980s from respected institutions such as the National Transportation Safety Board and the American Gas Association, warning gas companies nationwide of the pullout potential and the coupling's limitations. Why? Because people were being killed and injured all over the country. The coupling that leaked and killed the Cryers was installed in 1979 by Lone Star Gas, the company that used to own the current Atmos system. In 1980, the coupling's manufacturer warned Lone Star officials that the couplings will not meet new federal regulations.
Soon after, Ship was back on the air with some big news.
Now tonight with an update. Brett?
Gloria, 2.5 weeks ago, we began airing a series of stories about deadly natural gas fittings still in use under the North Texas soil. We also reported on the reluctance of state regulators, the Texas Railroad Commission, to do anything about it. But tomorrow morning in Austin, the Railroad Commission is expected to do an about-face.
All in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, signify by saying nay. Motion carries.
Nay.
Railroad commissioners voted 2-1 to order an estimated 100,000 unsafe couplings pulled out of the ground immediately. The couplings affected are the ones attached to gas meters, typically those installed in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. Railroad Commission Chairman Michael Williams says it was his decision to have the couplings removed and hinted that it had nothing to do with the News 8 investigation.
Over the course of time, you have to go back and look at the system. You have to go back and look at your regulatory and safety regime. You've got to make improvements to it. And that's what we did today.
In May of 2008, Ship followed up with a report on campaign contributions and the Texas Railroad Commission.
And a News 8 analysis of Commission Chairman Michael Williams' January campaign report shows of the 400,000 he's raised, 42% came from individuals with ties to the oil and gas industry. Critics say those percentages are hard to ignore.
After months of refusing Ship's interview requests, Williams sat down with the reporter. He defended the commission's integrity and denied any implication that he is beholden to the oil and gas industry.
I reject that notion. I am very, very confident in the fact that I make decisions based upon facts and based upon good sound policy and based upon what I think is in the best interest of my fellow Texans.
In November 2008, Williams was elected to a new 6-year term on the Railroad Commission. As for Brett Shipp, he has received hundreds of emails and calls responding to his reporting, and not just from residents worried about gas leaks. He's gotten tips that have hinted at stories involving serious problems within the oil and gas infrastructure across the state.
It's my job to make sure that these issues are brought to the public's attention and that the public is educated on the function of this agency. So it's all above board. If we quit hearing complaints from people that the system is unfair and people quit dying, then we can quit reporting.
For now, he says, he's going to stay on that beat.
Okay, here's a retake. Coming in 3, 2, 1.